الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين حبيب إله العالمين محمد وآله الطيبين الطاهرين صلوات اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المكرمين. Once again we give thanks to Allah for giving us this opportunity. And as you know, brothers and sisters, before we start with this class, I want us to raise up our hands and continue to make dua, inshallah, for the Shias of Nigeria. As you know, today we were expecting a good news, but unfortunately, it has been postponed again until next week, Monday. So we believe in this ayah of Quran. Allah says, وَمَكَرُوا وَمَكَرَ اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ خَيْرُ الْمَاكِرِينَ. They plan and we plan, meaning Allah, and He's the best of the planners. So as one of the brothers was mentioned today earlier on, the least we can do, if we can do anything, is not to forget the Shias of Nigeria, especially Sheikh Zak Zaki and his wife, in our du'as every day. Maybe because of you, because of my du'a, Allah will intervene on their behalf and makes it easy for him, because he's been denied his basic human right. I mean, you go to prisons everywhere in the world, even the murderers, their health is taken care of. Number one, he has not been found guilty so far, and they are still keeping him, and his health is deteriorating. Inshallah, let's keep making dua. And through this dua, inshallah, Allah Ta'ala will make it easy. So let's recite 5 times Amma Yajib al-Muttar. Through the barakat of this ayah, Allah Ta'ala make it easy for him, inshallah, and his wife and the members of his community. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Amma Yajib al-Muttarra idha da'ahu wa yakshif al-su. Amma Yajib al-Muttarra idha da'ahu wa yakshif al-su. أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء أمن يجيب المضطر إذا دعاه ويكشف السوء صلوات اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد. So our discussion was on يعلم ما بين أيديهم وما خلفهم, if you remember very well. So we discussed a lot on this part of the ayah. Ya'lamu ma bayna aydihim wa ma khalfahum. We'll conclude on it and then we'll go to the next line, inshallah. So the translation of this part of the ayah is that, I'm going to write the translation and then I will explain. He knows what is before them and what is after them. We looked at the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and how the knowledge of Allah is encompassing, that it encompasses everything. And then if you recall very well, towards the end of the lesson we had, we're looking at the basic requirements of being a learned person is to become an humble person. Knowledge is just to make you humble. Humble, of course, with Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, and humble with the creatures of Allah subhanahu. Because at the end of the day, that knowledge which you have is not your knowledge. The source of the knowledge is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what I'm going to do, we're going to now look at the meanings of يَعْلَمُ مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ. What does it mean? There are few meanings that are thrown in the commentaries, Let's look at them, and then we look at the one which is more of like very strong in the lens of Quran and the traditions of Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasalam. To understand when we say, or when Quran says before them and when Quran says after them, what sort of knowledge is Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is talking about. So therefore, there are few opinions among Mufassirin. So we look at the opinions, and then inshallah we take which one we believe is the most strongest opinion. The first opinion is this, that what is before them means, this is very, very important, worldly affairs. It means all their worldly affairs are known by Allah. Before you even think of doing them, Allah knows them. So therefore, ma bayna aydihim. The first meaning of it means what? Their worldly affairs, their worldly matters. And then they said, what is after them? Meaning, hereafter. They are matters of hereafter. Allah knows everything. What's going to happen? How is it going to happen? Who is going to get what? How is she or he going to get? Who are going to Jannah? May Allah grant us. Who are going to Nar? May Allah save us and protect us from it. So therefore, ma bayna aydihim, according to some commentators, meaning their worldly affairs. Wa ma khalfahum, meaning what? Their ukhrawi affairs. So this is the first opinion. Second opinion is the opposite of the first opinion. What's the opposite? Ma bayna aydihim. According to second opinion, it means or it refers to their affairs of akhirah. Allah knows everything. Wama khalfahum, meaning Allah knows their affairs of dunya. That there is no step that a person will take either in dunya and akhirah, and Allah doesn't know about it. Now let's look at the third opinion, which is very interesting opinion. The third opinion is that he said, ma bayna aydihim wa ma khalfahum, meaning what is before them and what is after them together. It refers to the following. One, rewards of their actions. Ajrul insan. Ajrul a'mal aw thawabul a'mal. Meaning all the rewards of your actions are known by Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. Within a twinkle of an eye. So according to some, when Allah says he knows what is before them and after them, he's talking about either the consequences of their actions or the repercussions of their actions, whether good or bad. That is the meaning according to this third opinion, that ma bayna aydihim wa ma khalfahum. But that's not the only one on the third opinion. They said it also means all their good deeds. A'malul khayra. So all your good deeds, Allah knows. So why do you brag? Why do you raise your shoulder? Why do you go out there thinking that you are the only one doing the right thing? Why do you label me? Why do I label you? Why do I become holier than thou? Indeed, if I know that even to do the action is tawfiq from Allah, I will be humble. So therefore, ya'lamu ma bayna aydihim wa ma alfahum. Bima'ana ya'lamu a'malahum al-khayra. Allah knows all their goodies and actions. There are many people, brothers and sisters, who want to do good. And as they make an attempt in doing good, something will pull them back and they will stop. So the fact that I and you are able to do doesn't mean that we are better than the others. It's just tawfiq from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why I remember that beautiful line, Omar Taufiki illa billah. So therefore, based on this, and there's still another point also on the third I will add. It means what? A'malul khaira. Your good deeds and your good action. La, bad deeds. It's not only good deeds. Also the bad deeds, awi sharira. Bimana, you can't hide anything. يَعْلَمُ مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ. You can hide from me, I can hide from you. When I come here, I stand in front of you wearing my kanzu, I look like holier than that. But when I'm alone in my car, or I go to market, what I do, nobody knows here in the mosque, isn't it? Only Allah. Only we have usnul zan, which is very important in Islam, isn't it? But then, if I and you are smart, in a true sense of being smart, then nobody will even think of doing wrong. Because why? You know Allah ya'lamu ma bayna aydihim wa ma khalfahum. He knows even the bad deeds that you do. One ayah of Quran you remember very well. Ya'lamu kha'inata al-a'yuni wa ma tukhfi as-sudur. He knows the twinkling of an eye and what is hidden in our breast or in our hearts. That even Allah knows. So therefore, according to some of us, when Quran says, مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ, he's telling us, you know what? Relax. You can't hide anywhere. Wherever you go, Allah knows about it. And that is also very, very important. No, some scholars said still under this one, Allah knows what you know and what you do not know. Huh? What you know, Allah knows. What you do not know, Allah knows. So if you look at all these three opinions, definitely, Allah is even higher than all this thing that we've just mentioned in these three opinions. But then some are saying, no, he knows what you know and what you do not know. That is that. Now let's go to Quran and look at some verses of Quran as to what is the meaning of يَعْلَمُ مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ. Let's check. Oh, sorry. Let's look at some verses of glorious Quran. And this is very important, brothers and sisters, because it encompasses all that we have just elaborated. You know? They said, this number one opinion, and then we go to number two from the Quran again. They said, يَعْلَمُ مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا أَلْفَهُمْ. It refers to his knowledge of time and space. I will tell you what does it mean. Makan, zaman. And there is not a single time you'll do something and he doesn't know. There is not a place that you'll sit and do something and Allah doesn't know. So they said, مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ مَا أَلْفَهُمْ. He's talking about makan and zaman. And this zaman, brothers and sisters, is talking about qabl wa ba'd. Before and after. When this knowledge before you do it and after you do it is the same. Our knowledge of something before and after are different. I may have general knowledge before something happens, but then I will have detailed knowledge after it happens. So therefore, and I will give you verse of Quran to support this idea and or this opinion. That it talks about makan and zaman, time and space. Now let's look at some verses of Quran. Chapter A'raf, verse 17. That's the first verse I want us to look at. Chapter A'raf, verse 17.
So we look at all these things just to strengthen our tawheed, you know. Our iman in Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Chapter A'raf. This is not working. Chapter A'raf, verse 17. I want you just to look at this ayah. I'm going to ask you a question. It's really very detailed ayah. Then I will come to them from before them and from behind them, and on their right and on their left, and you will not find most of them grateful to you. What do you get from this? Who can tell me? What do you get from this ayah? لَآتِي ثُمَّ لَآتِيَنَّهُمْ مِنْ بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمِنْ خَلْفِهِمْ وَعَنْ أَيْمَانِهِمْ وَعَنْ شَمَائِرِهِمْ وَلَا تَدْعَ أَكْثَرُهُمْ شَاكِرِينَ. أحسنتم. That's one, shaitan. He's talking about shaitan. He's going to come to you all round. But then, where does Allah fit in depths of knowledge? Who can tell me? Huh? Eh? After. Yeah. You see, very good. Where Allah comes in the end, wala tajid aktharu mushakirin. Shakirin, not shakirin li shaitan, shakirin lillahi azza wa jalla. And if shaitan will come to you left and right with his limited knowledge, it means Allah knows everything about you. If you know everything about your son, before even your son, think of, because of being your son, born in the same house, look after him. What of Allah ta'ala? How did shaitan know? Shaitan understood insan and how insan approached things. So now if shaitan, with limited knowledge, is able to come to you left, right, front, back, what of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala? So he's trying to say, if this is limited, then unlimited knowledge is something else. But the point I'm trying to arrive here is what? وَلَا تَجِدُ أَكْثَرَهُمْ شَاكِرِينَ. Most of us, we are not grateful to Allah. We know Allah sees us. We know Allah knows. But still, we go against Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. And look at the other ayah also, which is very important. Ali Imran 71. Chapter Ali Imran 71. Ali Imran 71. Look at the ayah. O people of the scripture, Ahlul Kitab, why do you confuse the truth with falsehood and conceal the truth while you know it? What does it mean? What do you get from this ayah? Yeah. Yeah. Of course, it's talking about Ahlul Kitab, but it's like talking to us. Insan, you know Allah knows. But why do you go ahead and stand against him? Your conscience tells you what I'm doing is wrong, isn't it? If you do wrong and your conscience doesn't tell you it's wrong, then you're dead. So Allah is talking in the Kitab. تَكْتُمُونَ الْحَقَّ وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. You know the truth, but you're concealing it. It's like talking to us. You know Allah knows everything about you. Why? So sometimes I tell people, simple thing is about you know very well. Delaying salah is injustice to oneself. Why do you delay? And Allah sees you. Today, there is no one who does something wrong and he knows that is not right. Allah knows. So Allah is just trying to draw our attention to say, you know what? You know through your conscience, you know what you are doing is wrong. But you keep doing it. And that is also very, very important. No, there is also another meaning from Quran again. That ya'ani Allahu ya'lam ma kana fil madi aw fil mustaqbal. Meaning this ya'lam ma bayna aydihim, meaning what Allah knows. So this is four, right? Five. Knows what is in the past and future. What is in the past, he knows everything. And of course, that's why the Quran tells us the stories of the prophets and the stories of the people of God and those who disobey God in the past. And then, of course, Quran tells us also the story of those who will come after us. Allah indeed knows that. But now what is interesting is what? After this, she said, Ya alam ma bayna idma alfa. Then he said what? Wala yuhituna bi shay'in min ilmi. Let's stop there. It's very interesting. It's really interesting part. Wala yuhituna bi shay'in min ilmi. It's all about knowledge, brothers and sisters. So we look at this next one. وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِنْ عِلْمِ Leave illa bimasha. That's the next line we'll do. وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِنْ عِلْمِهِ illa bimasha. Let me look at the right translation of it. They cannot, and they cannot comprehend anything out of his knowledge except what he pleases. Yuhituna. Then bishayin min elmi. These are two things here. We need to dissect it properly. Let me ask you a question. All of you. If you look at this part of the ayah, they cannot comprehend anything of knowledge without his permission. What do you get out of this ayah? Who can tell me? The moment you see, What do you get out of this? وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنْ عِلْمِهِ One, all knowledge is from him. Good. Any other? That's true, 100%, but there is another one. Any other? Nothing happens without his permission. That's Mashiach. We'll discuss that. Any other? That's illa bi masha. Any other? Ability to understand excellent is from him. That is illa bi masha. Very good. Mashiach. We'll discuss that. See, this part is an emphasis on what we have just discussed. يَعْلَمُ مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ If it has stopped there, it's enough for us. But then he said, وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنْ عِلْمِ To shed more light about his knowledge. So the first thing that comes to mind is what? This part is an emphasis on the previous part of the ayah. It's تَأْكِيد عَلَىٰ عِلْمِ It is an emphasis on the knowledge of Allah. That's very, very important. Otherwise, you could have stopped saying, Ya alam ma bayna idma khalfahum. That's more than enough, really, to say, I know the knowledge of Allah. But now he's telling us, Wala yuhituna, this one is what? It's an emphasis on the previous line about his knowledge. It's an emphasis. It's emphasizing about his knowledge. That indeed, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala has the knowledge. And then of course, number two, like what you mentioned before we look at it more into details in Quran. No one has the power to know anything without the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And which I will justify. No one has the power to acquire knowledge without Allah's permission. It's not possible. وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنْ عِلْمِ And that is why Prophet mentioned, أَلْعِلْمُ نُورٌ يَكْذِفُهُ اللَّهُ فِي كَلْمَةٍ Some said it's not a hadith. Said knowledge is light. Allah drops it in the heart of whomsoever he pleases. If you humble yourself to Allah, I guarantee you Allah will give you knowledge. See, knowledge of Allah is different from the knowledge of dunya. Because the moment I start the knowledge of dunya, I'm doing it because I want to get rizq, isn't it? Knowledge of Allah is to purify your heart. So there is no one, even the knowledge of dunya will come to that according to the wire. Without Allah's permission, no one can have it. So that's the second line we get from this ayah. Number three line we get from this ayah is what? Allah grant knowledge to whomsoever He pleases. And this, there is discussion here. Allah grant knowledge to whomsoever He pleases. Sometimes you may have a lot of knowledge, but there is no barakah in it. You know what is barakah? Barakah is effect. Effects. You may have knowledge like more than any other person. You talk to people just now, they get fascinated. They go out, nothing happened to them. That's the reality of the world we are living today. People get carried away. People get fascinated. Ooh, she's got knowledge. But if you look at the impact of it in changing people's life positively, it's zero. Wallahi, zero. I always look at the life of Ahlul Bayt, especially the 11th Imam, who did not have an opportunity to sit with people like this. But with Ishara, because he was on parole, like a parole of today, quote unquote, with Ishara, look at the impact he had on people. So when I talk of knowledge and having knowledge, it's not just having the information. Of course, having the information is a step. But the impact of the information you have on you and on people that you share with is the most important thing. If there is no impact, then there is no point. So therefore, yes, Allah grant knowledge to whomsoever He pleases. Ma'rifah is very, very important. Now here, brothers and sisters, I want to say something. You know, if you want Allah to grant you knowledge, but maybe I will quantify it, beneficial knowledge. Beneficial knowledge. Divine knowledge. What is important is your sincerity. Ikhlas. In acquiring it and in giving it, you must be sincere. Otherwise, you may have the knowledge, but it will not be beneficial. But that's not enough. Ikhlas is not enough. That's the first step. Second, which is very important, effort and determination. Effort is very important. Without effort, wallah, insan will not get anywhere. And so when you make effort, you explore. Exploration. But then the last, which is the most important, is what? Seeking divine intervention. As you explore, as you learn, ask Allah to help you. Prophet said, Rabbi Zidni Ilma. You remember we quoted this ayah before. Allah, increase me. You need God. I know when you have exams, you sit and make dua. Allah, I want to pass. No? You want to have the knowledge of Quran? You want to really understand and appreciate Ahlul Bayt? Your effort alone is not enough. Sincerity alone is not enough. Sit. Ask Allah specifically to give you the if you believe that the knowledge is from Him. You have to ask Him. And if you ask him, there is no way Allah will deny you. And so therefore, before we go forward, you remember this tradition of the prophets when it comes to knowledge acquisition. There are four things that when one goes out to acquire knowledge, should know that there is no limitation about it. First one, in terms of knowledge, I'm doing this just to encourage you, to inspire you. You know what? You can still acquire a lot of knowledge if you want. No time limits, isn't it? No time limits. There's no time to say, no, now I'm young or I'm old. What is interesting is that we are Shias. If you look at Shia world, our scholars are the oldest and they are the most learned. The ulama, ayatollahs, they are very old. But the sharpness of their brain are more than us. We can't compare. We've got all the resources, technology, they don't have it. Their phone, when you look at it, you laugh. Some of them even don't have phone. As Stanley, he doesn't have phone. Except the phone in the house. But look at the amount of knowledge they have. Allah, when you sit next to them like with 2-3 people, that's the time you understand their knowledge. Look at Ayatollah Waheed Khorasani. They've all passed 80, heading to 90. Makarim Shirazi. Bajati, how old he left this world. Effort, sincerity, and seeking divine intervention. Maraji Nkom, in the darkness of the night, will walk from their homes to Haram of Bibi Masuma, seeking divine intervention to open their brains. People who have written books, they've got multiple students who are mujtahideen. Today, me, if I've got one mujtahid, I brag. I've done the best. That's why there is no barakah in our knowledge, I'm telling you. Because you have lost it. I'm competing with you, you are competing with me. I want to show the world I've got people. You want to show the world you've got people. We've lost the track, don't you see? The knowledge, there is no barakah, wallah. You go Najaf, you go Qom, Hawzat al-Alamiya, all over. So Shuyukh are very old, but the mind is too powerful. The way they analyze things, I can't. This tafsir I'm teaching you, where am I getting from? From them. From their tafsir books, isn't it? I see it, I read. Some of it I was taught in class in Qom when I was in Qom. Like Mizan, I used to sit in class, they used to teach us. We didn't finish all, but we did chunk of it. We got the base of understanding it. And these are old people. Ayatollah Jawadi Amuli. He's got tafsir Tasneem, powerful tafsir. If not equal to Mizan, more than Mizan. Jafar Subhani. So therefore, you need sincerity. So try to understand there is no time. And the simple tradition is that of the Prophet, you know. Min al-Mahdi ila al-Lahad. You know it. From cradle to grave. Just to support this. From the time you arrive, because the first knowledge is sensory knowledge. And then it becomes intellectual knowledge. So that's why he said from cradle to grave. So don't stop. Wallah. Come class. Class is not alone. Read. Explore. Argue, ask questions, debate. Because through argument, through debate, you get to know more. Because if you don't read more, you're inhibiting your intellect. If it had to function to a certain level, you'd bring it to the lower level. Someone who reads, of course, you don't overread. But someone who reads is sharp or she's sharp. That's why our ulama are very powerful. Look at the books they wrote in. Allahu Akbar. So there is no time limit. That's one. We need to understand. Two. No gender limit, isn't it?
It's not about male or female, really. It's not about male and female. We have Imam Ali, we have Bibi Fatima. You've got Imam Hussein, you've got Bibi Zainab. So Prophet said, Talabul ilm, ilmi faridatun ala kulli muslimin wa muslima. Seeking knowledge is obligatory upon female Muslim and male Muslim. This riwayah from the Prophet is obligatory, is in wajib. On a male to seek knowledge and on a female. There are those who will spend many months, they've not even thought of acquiring one thing about Islam. But it's wajib. Knowledge precede everything in Islam, by the way. Because without knowledge, there is no proper ibadah. That is why they said, if you've got money, one for mosque, and there is no money for school, madrasa, leave the mosque and build madrasa. Because it overpowers it. Otherwise, people will go and pray blindly. The maqam of a scholar, a teacher, is higher than the maqam of an abid without knowledge. Somebody sitting making under the rakah. You are sitting reading one ayah, and he doesn't know what he is doing. You are much better than him in the eye of Allah. This riwayah is hadith of the Prophet. You are much higher. Isn't the Prophet said, when you go seeking knowledge, you are walking on the wings of the angels, isn't it? It's a metaphor to say all creatures of Allah are asking for forgiveness on your behalf. What do I say? At-tal-hitana filma. Even the fishes that you don't see in water, the moment you make your mind, I'm going to acquire a knowledge about Allah, Allah will order them to ask for forgiveness on your behalf. Akbarul jihad talabul ilm. The greatest jihad is seeking knowledge. So there is no gender limit. That's why Prophet said, the day you teach your child Bismillah, Allah dissolve all your sins. Allah grant you a child, Bismillah, that Bismillah. That moment, Allah dissolve your sins. Kafara for you. So therefore, there is no gender limit. Three. There is no space limit. No space limit. If there is knowledge here, take it. Utlubu al-ilma walau bisin, Prophet said. Seek knowledge if it's in China. It's a metaphor. To say, if where you are there is no knowledge, and you realize the need for the knowledge, go wherever you want to go and get the knowledge. Imam Ali alayhi salam. Seeking God with empty stomach is the best way, but many are seeking God with the stomach filled. And he said, to seek knowledge in a foreign land is the quickest way of acquiring knowledge, but many are seeking it in their comfort zone. See, Imam Ali alayhi salam. Yeah, so empty is me. Yeah, it's real. That don't eat too much. Because with comfort, you can get. Eat so that you are able to. But the moment it's too much. And it's true. I mean, if I go study somewhere where I'm not in my comfort, the seriousness is different, isn't it? But if I want to study in the house, I do a little bit as well. But someone who goes to the library is different ball again. But in the house, I lay on my bed a little bit, I read a little bit, I switch off my phone. But when I go out to town library, there are people even, they don't know the community library of their ward. People don't know. I ask people, I said, have you learned? He said, which library? I said, what is this? Library is from your tax. Go borrow books. But people don't go. You got areas, libraries filled with books, people don't go. I said, Papa, take your own book, go there once a week, once a month, read some.
People don't do.
So therefore, there is no space.
And then the last one is what? Number four. There is no teacher limit. Male or female can teach you. Young or old can teach you. It doesn't matter. So long as the person has the knowledge, learn from the person. You just learn, you learn it and go home. Prophet said,
"Al-hikmatu dhalatu al-mu'mini haythu wajadaha akhadaha."
He said, "Wisdom is a lost sheep of a believer. Wherever he finds it, he takes it." So if I find it in Fatima, I take. From Shahida Antu, I take. From Mahrush, I take. From Sayyid, I take.
So there is no teacher limit.
So long as the knowledge is there, you have to take it. So these are the four pillars that seeking knowledge requires for us to remember. Unless, na'udhu billah, one cannot function completely out of sickness, then that's something else. Why all these things are important? Because it will show how determined an effort you are putting to get that knowledge from Allah. And this brings me to the last part. You know, the knowledge of Allah is encompassing, brothers. So this, talking about this, knowledge is encompassing. And that's what I want us to look at from Quran. This ihata. وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ Ihata. They can't comprehend. You see, he said they can't comprehend. But ihata means not encompassing. His knowledge encompasses everything. So you make your efforts, but don't forget him. So let's look at some few verses here. The first verse I want us to look at is Surah Saba, verse 3. Surah Saba, verse 3. Allah, the moment you stop acquiring knowledge, that's the beginning of your failure. And the beginning of arrogance to take place in you. So this Surah Saba, verse 3. So if you look at the ayah, it's talking about the knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encompassing. So, but those who disbelieve say, the hour will not come to us. Yes, by my Lord, it will surely come to you. Allah is the knower of the unseen, not absent from him. It's an atom's weight within the heavens or within the earth, or what is smaller than that or greater. Except what? Look at the last part of the ayah. Go up. Except surely come to you. Allah is the knower of the unseen. Not absent from him is an atom's weight within the heavens or within the earth, or what is smaller than that or greater, except that it is in a clear register. It is registered by Allah. Allah knows. That is ihata al-ilmiya. Meaning his knowledge is encompassing. He comprehends everything into. That's one ayah. Another ayah is Surah Talaq, verse 12. And then we have Surah Nisa, verse 26. This is the commentary of this ayah from the Quran. And then you have Fussilat, verse 50. Oh, I'm writing in Arabic. 54. And then Buruj, verse 20. So if we look at Talaq, we go to Talaq, verse 12. Look at it. It is Allah who has created seven heavens and of the earth the like of them. His command descends among them, so you may know that Allah is over all things competent, and that Allah has encompassed all things in knowledge. So, وَلَا يُحِيطُونَ بِشَيْءٍ مِنْ عِلْمِهِ. That ihata, Allah has it. He encompassed. So if you really want to acquire knowledge and you don't want to put Allah in, then up to you. But I will definitely tell you for free, seeking knowledge or imparting knowledge without divine intervention will deprive you of the barakah.
If you think it's just your effort and you don't need God, there's no baraka in it. And I told you, baraka is what? It's just to touch the heart of one person. You can't touch the heart of everybody. But if you are able to touch the heart of a person, someone, then there is some glimpses of sincerity. And that should humble you to go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And there's another one, of course, you know, Surah An-Nisa. Again, 126. That also tells us the knowledge of Allah is encompassing without a shadow of doubt. So if you look at it, وَلِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ مُحِيطًا. That ihata yuhituna. If you look at all these verses I'm giving you, there is that word ihata. It's so important. So if you come to tafsir category as 9, and I said, Zain, you come Lady Fiddah Quran competition, and then you get wala yuhituna bishame. Just pull all these verses down, and then you will make the judges speechless. Since you are doing Quran by Quran. Because you are pulling verses, the same terminology has been used there. And you get all the details, that's what we want. Quran by Quran. That is the authentic. Because I'm using Quran to explain Quran. Before I go to hadith or some philosophical way of looking at it, I just use Quran. Nobody can challenge you when you use Quran. Who is going to challenge you? It's Quran. At the end of the day, our imam said, يُفَسِّرُ بَعْدُهَا بَعْدًا. It explains each other. That's Quran. So therefore, ihata is very important. And the next one, Fusilat 54. Again, you will find the word repeating itself there. If you check Fusilat 54. Are we getting the Fusilat 54? Ah, very good. Look at it. ألا إنهم في مرية من لقاء ربهم ألا إنه بكل شيء محيط ولا يحيطون إحاطة. Unquestionably, they are in doubt about the meeting with their Lord. That's day of judgment. They doubt. But Allah said, unquestionably, He is of all things encompassing. He knows it. محيطة. Meaning you've got the power over it. What does it mean to have a power over something? You created it. So knowledge is a creature of Allah. He's got the power over the knowledge. Because it's muhit. And then of course, if you look at even the simple verse, Surah Al-Buruj verse 20 again. Buruj verse 20 again tells us this. If you look at it. Buruj verse 20. Look at it. Ihata. Wallahu min waraihim muhit. While Allah encompasses them from behind. He knows what you don't see. If I walk, I don't see my back. You see. But Allah sees it before you even see. If I'm not next to you, you will not know. But wherever you go, muhitun. So wala yuhituna bi shay'in min ilm. They will not be able to comprehend anything of knowledge. This be shay'in min ilmi, anything of his knowledge without his permission. So therefore, if you truly want to acquire knowledge which is mubarak, which is beneficial, don't forget Allah. When you pray, Allah, raise up your hand, ask Allah, Allah, illuminate my heart with knowledge. You know that dua, Allahumma rizukuni fahman nabi. وَحِفْزَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ وَإِلْهَامَ مَلَائِكَةُ الْمُكَرَّمِينَ. This is very powerful dua for knowledge. Oh Allah, رُزُقُنِي فَحْمَ النَّبِيِّ. Bless me with the understanding of the prophets. وَحِفْزَ الْمُرْسَلِينَ. Ya Allah, bless me with the memory of the messengers. وَإِلْهَامَ مَلَائِكَةُ الْمُكَرَّمِينَ. Ya Allah, bless me with the inspiration of the angels. So that's what we need. Put Allah in your way of acquiring knowledge. That is why they said, you know, there is a very good book which we used to study back then in Ghana about knowledge. They said, الا لا تنال العلم الا بسته سانبيك عن مجموعها ببيانها. He said you will never acquire knowledge until and unless you fulfill the following. So it says zakaun wa hirthun. The first one they said is what? Passion. So you remember, he said effort, determination, passion. You need passion. Without passion, then he said wastibar, patience. If you are not patient, you will have a very shallow knowledge. Because sometimes things can be very difficult. Sometimes you're trying to understand something and it's not coming right. So you need istibar, you need patience. You need patience to open book to read before you sleep. You need patience to open Quran after Fajr. How many people are consistent with that? That they end their night with Quran and open their day with Quran. What better way to open Quran? Close with it. It's one ayah, two ayah, three ayah. Reflect in the morning before you go out or before you start your errands, and then close with Quran. Make wudu before you sleep, few verses. Or your children before they sleep, let them make wudu. Come sit, recite whatever they know, then you put them to bed. Barakah. It opens mind a lot. So effort is very important, but it needs patience. And then, of course, the last one, he said, one needs tawfiq of Allah. So that tawfiq is what? Seeking divine intervention. Make dua. Dua. Why would Allah deny you the knowledge? Why is He giving others and He said, no? And so therefore, inshallah, mu'minin and mu'minat. The practical lesson we learn from this line is what? Knowledge, no doubt, belongs to Allah. But don't let others go and leave you behind. Don't just be a member of the caravan, be active member of the caravan, of the ummah of prophets. Seek it based on your capability. And lastly, they said, بِكَدْرِ الْكَدَّ تُكْتَسَبُ الْمَعَانِ وَمَنْ رَامَ الْمُنَى لَيْلًا يَقُومُ. It's very beautiful poem. They said, your maqam, your position, is dependent on the levels of your pain. How much have you suffered? How many books have you read? You know, sometimes, you know, knowledge is funny sometimes, but mysterious. You'll be reading and not getting anything. But wallah, one time, you'll see all that you've been reading are coming. Sometimes you read a book, zero, you know. You put it somewhere. After 1 month, 2 months, Allah give it to you. When you take the book, it becomes walkover. But those who read constantly, they understand these kind of things. Sometimes one ayah becomes very complicated. You try to explore different, you know, sources or resources to be able to get to the meaning of it. It doesn't matter. You close it, you go somewhere. Sometimes, again, you come, you open, you start, and the knowledge is there. So knowledge needs effort and determination. So they said, وَمَنْ رَامَ الْمُنَى لَيْلَ يَكُمْ. Said, whoever wants position, but position meaning in the eye of Allah. Layla yakum, you should then wake up at night. Learn. Read. You see, if you look at the current situation of Muslim ummah is not a reading ummah. Seriously. Because if you read history, really, of course, companions of Abu Abdullah, in terms of Iman, nobody can come next to them. Because they had the Masoom. Companions of a prophet, some of them. They had Masoom, yes, present. But the means of acquiring knowledge that we have today, they never had. Yes, the baraka of Masum in the Bible. We believe also Masum is alive today, although we don't have physical access to him. They had no comfort. They were going to their imams to learn, and enemies were up and armed against them. We have all the comforts. How many verses of Quran have you memorized? If you're a Muslim, give me tafsir of Izaja Nasrullah of head. Simple one. Without reading. When have you been a Muslim? Okay, now give me the book of Shakespeare that you read last year. Can you remember the book you read when you were at university? Oh yeah, I can remember. Okay, give me one ayah of Quran that you love so much with this tafsir. Just give me one. So this is the situation of the Ummah. We've got the resources. We've got the Quran. The books are printed, but only few are working for it. So if we don't take it to the next level, the next generation will not take it to the next level, especially this millennial generation. If we don't prioritize Quran, Sunnah of Prophet and Ahlul Bayt, and prefer certain author's book over that, that's what we're going to have. Non-Muslims will interpret Quran for us, and that is the reality today. Sometimes you find a Muslim hearing non-Muslim interpreting, you think, oh, this is astonishing. It's Baba, you've not learned anything about Islam. So it's so important. Quran becomes our slogan. And a Muslim must make it a point to explore this deen. Companions of Ahlul Bayt, alayhimus salam, they used to explore. But as I said, their means was too limited, too restricted. There are no books like this. Things were on skins. Some were missing at one stage. But through the barakat of the presence of Ahlul Bayt, they managed some. Some no enemies did not allow them. We are free. Technology is a hujjah. Let's use it wisely to make Ahlul Bayt proud to acquire knowledge. And if you acquire and you make mistakes, Allah forgive. But if you don't acquire and you make mistakes, there is no forgiveness. Islam is not just to be a Muslim and pray and you don't read now and then. No, that's not Islam. That's not Islam. Islam means what? You keep reading and exploring until you die. That's Islam. That's Islam. That's the true nature of Islam, isn't it? Since I like that ayah. Rabbi zidni ilma. Prophet keep doing until he died. To show and you, I and you that no, it's about knowledge. Iqra. Allah gave to Prophet. First ayah. Iqra. So therefore, let's try, inshallah. Let's be encouraged. Let's be inspired. Let's keep reading based on our capability. Let's try slowly, slowly. Well, I'm telling you, if slowly you're doing, don't do too much, more than you can't bite. You can't bite. Do little, but by the time you realize you have accumulated so much, you'll be shocked. You know, you have to get to a point whereby if you don't read, you feel something is missing in you. And for you to do that, you need to inculcate the love of it. I mean, there are people that I know, even if they are exhausted to that life, you know, max, they can't sleep without reading. The students were studying together in Hausa would come back late for program, for ziyara, mafsuma, Thursday. But the person would go and read before he sleep. So that shows how determined we are. So inshallah, let's try our level best. So in short, what are you here to do? So inshallah, next time we look at that mashia. Illa bi mashallah. What does it mean? What is mashia of Allah? Then we'll understand that there is no movement without Allah's approval. Although he's talking about knowledge, but then we'll look at it under general. That mashia of Allah is what I and you need to be able to unlock whatever we do in life. وصلى الله على محمد وآله. You have any question, you can ask.